Hi everyone. So I've decided to start a series of videos on Olympiad questions. So that might be questions from the International Mathematical Olympiad, the Australian Mathematical Olympiad, possibly even the Putnam competition, which isn't really an Olympiad, but same sort of level of difficulty, and just whatever other Olympiads I can find from around the world. So if you're not familiar with my channel, I already have a series of videos on very hard maths questions for the younger students, so around 13 years old, and also quite hard questions for the older students, around 17 years old. So if you're looking for something a bit easier than Olympiads, you might want to check out those playlists. So Olympiad questions are really, really hard. And they're hard even for me. Now I'm saying that as someone who has a degree in physics, first class honours, I was top of my year in maths again and again. I've had a lot of extracurricular problem solving practice. So even for me, they're really, really hard. So I just wanted to emphasize growth mindset here, because I feel like even though they're really hard for me even now, I'm gonna get better and better at them. And you're probably in the same boat. Like when you look through these Olympiad questions, you might feel completely demoralized and just defeated because they are really hard. But the more you do them, the more you try to understand them and read through the solutions and work on them, the better and better you'll get. Now, the question that I've chosen to work on today is one that I actually could do. I found one that was easy enough. So this is from the 2017 International Mathematical Olympiad, and I'll put a link below to where you can download that paper. So you might want to pause the video here, read through the question, and see if you can figure out how to prove it. All right. Now, the first thing that I would do with a question like this is just try to sort of draw up a particular rectangle and play around with it just to make sure that I understand the question completely, because you know, some of this might be a bit confusing. This distances or odd or even what does that mean? So we get a much better idea if we draw a picture. So the first thing I did was draw up something like this. I made it a 7 by 15 rectangle. Often it's good to start with something small, but I felt like a smaller rectangle would be like, smaller rectangles would fill it up very quickly. So I wanted to make something bigger. So we've got a rectangle R with odd integer side lengths, and then we want to divide it into small rectangles. Now, I think that the first time that I read this, I thought that it would be sort of divided, like you'd draw a line down there and a line across there, and then you'd have like four rectangles in there, and like it had to be like that. And then I reread the question and realized, well, it could be something a bit more interesting, like we don't have to have straight lines going all the way across. So we might have something that looks maybe like this. So now we've divided it into small rectangles with integer side lengths. Prove that there is at least one among the small rectangles whose distances from the four... Okay, so what does that mean, distances from the four sides? Let's just pick one of these rectangles, like this one, for instance. So the four sides, so that's, you know, these four sides of the of R, its distance from this side, well, it's touching that side, so that distance is zero. Its distance from this side is like, you know, the number of squares between them. So that's 5. Distance to this side is just 4. And distance to that side is 4 as well. So that's what it means about the distances from the four sides. Now, we want them to be either all odd or all even. So we've got even, 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 odd. So that's not one of the small rectangles that it's talking about here. So maybe we can work out which one it means. Let's look at this one. So its distance from these two sides is both 0. And then the distance to this side is 4, and the distance to that side is 8, I think. Yeah. So that one has the distances all even. So that's one of the rectangles that it's talking about. So this sort of process of like drawing stuff up and trying a particular rectangle is really useful to help you understand the question. You're going to want to like reread the question a few times because it's easy to sort of think it says one thing when it actually says another thing. So this is very useful. Now, I played around with this for a while and I noticed that what we need is a rectangle with an odd width and height, because if it's even, then you've got like an odd number of squares left above and below it. Do you know what I mean? So you can't like split an odd number up into even and even or odd and odd. I hope that explanation made sense to you. If it doesn't, then just play around with it for a while by yourself and, you know, draw things out, see what happens, and you'll start to understand. So I thought that maybe a good first step might be trying to prove that there's always a rectangle with odd width and height. Like, it's usually a good idea to invent an easier problem for yourself to try to tackle first, before you tackle like the full problem, because proving that there's a rectangle with an odd width and height doesn't necessarily ensure that it's going to have these distances all odd and even, but it might be a good idea. So I think that was my first idea. I didn't really get anywhere with that, to be honest. So that didn't turn out to be useful. But then I started to see some similarities to a question that I read about a long time ago called the mutilated chessboard problem. God, that sounds awful. But the question goes like this. You've got a standard chessboard and you cut off the two opposite corners. So they're gone. And then the question is, can we tile that chessboard with dominoes? So I know kids these days don't really play with dominoes. So a domino is just a little rectangular thing like that. It's just like two squares stuck together, basically. So, you know, we might stick a domino on those two like that and stick another one there like that and so on. So you might like to pause the video here and see if you can work out the answer to that question. But okay, so what happens is you'll find that you can't tile the mutilated chessboard with dominoes because each domino covers one black and one white square because it covers two adjacent squares. And this chessboard that's been cut up has more black squares than white squares. So that's not going to work. We're going to be left with two black squares at the end, which aren't going to be adjacent, so we can't stick a domino on them. Okay, so that's that question. I don't remember where I read about that. I know that Martin Gardner covered it in one of his books, and I'll put a link to that below, but I don't think that that's where I read about it, because I seem to remember the author talking about how much harder the question would have been if it was just presented as, like, you've got an 8x8 grid and you cut off two opposite corners. Like, if they hadn't mentioned chessboards at all, you would sort of have to come up with this idea of colouring it in like a chessboard. And then that makes it a much harder question because you have to come up with this very creative idea of colouring it in like that. So that sort of stuck with me. I don't know how many years ago I read about this. If anyone can think of a book that mentions that and brings it up as like, what if it wasn't presented as a chessboard, then let me know in the comments, because I don't remember what book it was that I read that in. All right, so then what I did was color in my rectangle like this, like a chessboard. So let's play around with that idea. So you can try out various, you know, rectangles. We still want like ones with odd width and height, like we found before. So we might pick one like that. So that one has distance there of one, distance there of four, three again, and I mean odd again, and six there, so even, like that one. But that one's got mixed, so those two are even and those two are odd. So that's not what we want. Let's try another one. Let's do something like that. So that one's got a distance there of one distance there of one. Distance there is 9. And that distance is 3. So that one's got all odd. So that satisfies our condition there. So if you play around a bit, you'll see that what you want is a rectangle with all four corners black. Like this one has its four corners white. So why might that be? So going back to the idea of the mutilated chessboard problem, where the problem there was that there were too many black squares to cover with dominoes. So, well, if we look at this big rectangle, you'll find that it has more black squares than white squares. Now, this rectangle here with the four white corners, that has more white than black, whereas this one has more black than white. If you had a rectangle with mixed corners, so some of them black and some of them white, then you get an equal number of white and black squares within it. So you can kind of see the outline of proof here that there must be at least one rectangle with four black corners, because that's the only way that you're going to get more black squares than white squares in total. And a rectangle with four black corners is going to satisfy this condition. So that's basically the proof. That's the idea of the proof. So I wrote out something. I wrote this out. You can read through that if you want. It's just putting into words what I just said. What I just said was in words, but you know what I mean. Okay. I wasn't too happy with this sentence here, though. I just sort of glossed over the idea that a rectangle with all four black corners would satisfy this condition, would have either all odd or all even distances. So I feel like this is the kind of thing where if I was actually doing the Olympiad, I would probably write all that out and then sort of resolve to come back and flesh out that idea in more detail if I had time at the end. Now, to be honest, I couldn't actually think of a good way to word that and explain why a rectangle with four black corners is going to satisfy the condition. But I read in the solution, they explain it pretty well here. They're just using green instead of black and yellow instead of white. So what they've said is that because this is green and this is green, that means that that distance and that distance have the same parity. Now, parity just means whether something is even or odd. So they haven't explained why these both being green mean that these two numbers have to have the same parity. They just sort of held it as self-evident. But so they go on to say, like, okay, so X and U have to have the same parity. Now, because that's green and that's green, that means that that has to have the same parity as that, and so on around the rectangle. So all the numbers have to have the same parity. So that was a pretty good explanation. Now, I don't think I would have been able to solve this question if I hadn't heard of the mutilated chessboard question before. So one of the really important things for being good at mathematical problem solving is just having seen lots of different questions before and being able to apply solutions to old questions to new questions. So one really good source of questions like this is books by Martin Gardner. Also, Ian Stewart is another author who writes these sort of recreational mathematics books. And I'll put a link below to where you can get those sorts of books. It also reminded me of something that Paul Lockhart said in his article, A Mathematician's Lament. He was talking about the area of a triangle. So the way that he presents it is that you've got a box and a triangle that fits inside it like that. And you want to know what is the area of the triangle, like how much space of the box does it take up? So you get this brilliant idea to cut it like that. And then you can see that that is half of that and this is half of that. Therefore, the triangle area must be half of the box area. So he is making the point that the way they present it in schools is really not helpful, because they just say that the area of a triangle is half base times height. And that misses out the important thing. It's not the fact that triangles take up half their box that matters. What matters is the beautiful idea of chopping it with the line and how that might inspire other beautiful ideas and lead to creative breakthroughs in other problems. Something a mere statement of fact can never give you. So I want to make the point here that when you're learning new things in mathematics, you should always be trying to work out how people came up with that idea. Like, try to see the derivation and understand it, because that's the important part. The formulas and stuff and conclusions are really nice to know, that like they can be useful in many ways, but often what's more important is how that formula was derived, how people came to that conclusion. So if you want to be really good at mathematical problem solving, try to work out those things. All right, I hope this was helpful to you guys. If you enjoyed this video, then give it a like and consider subscribing. Now, I'm not sure what Olympiad question I'll be doing for the next video in this series. If you've got a particular one in mind that you'd like to see me go through, then let me know in the comments.